Hi, friends, and welcome to Gameday Eve from GoJacks.com. We are inside the nucleus, the brain trust of everything that happens in Jackrabbit football is here at the Dykhouse Student Athlete Center, and the brain trust of the Jackrabbit Sports Network is Mike Struck. He joins me to talk about the FCS quarterfinals. We'll get to that in a moment. 37-22, the win over Northern Iowa on Saturday, an impressive way to start the postseason for SDSU.
Well, that was the way you want to get started with your opening game in the playoffs for the Jacks, and that offense came out and took care of business in that first half, scoring on all five possessions and getting the lead and then allowing that defense to play with confidence.
Jacks have won six in a row, and during this six-game win streak, they have trailed for less than 7 minutes. Each time they trailed, only twice, they scored and retook the lead on the next possession. Pretty impressive what they've done here in recent history.
Oh, they're knocking on all cylinders right now, just getting the job done. They're playing with confidence. They're able to handle any adversity that's been thrown at them, and they just keep it rolling week after week.
Well, the fifth seed of Jackrabbits did get an early Christmas present from Central Arkansas. New Hampshire went on the road and beat UCA, which means that New Hampshire has to come to Brookings tomorrow afternoon. Kick will be at 2 o'clock at Dana J. Dykhouse Stadium. And this is a New Hampshire team that essentially is playing with house money, Strucky. 7-4 at the end of the regular season. They weren't sure they would get into the FCS playoffs, but their streak under Coach McDonald continues. They're back in the FCS postseason again, and they picked up two wins in a row to get to the round of eight.
Well, they did enough to put themselves into consideration for that playoff spot, and then since the selection committee made the announcements, they've just taken advantage of their opportunity, and they continue to play strong football week in and week out, and they're just riding the wave and playing their best football that they possibly can play.
FBS win over Georgia Southern no doubt helped on Selection Sunday as well. We talk about the offense, and quarterback Trevor Knight, who's been their starting quarterback all year long, went down with an injury in the second quarter going through concussion protocol. We don't know if Knight will start or if Christian Lupoli, the redshirt freshman, will start. Let's assume it's Knight to begin this year, and he's a guy that can run it, he can throw it. He's crafty back there.
He is. He's a very athletic quarterback. He makes good decisions. Maybe not the most physically imposing with his height, but certainly very capable. He throws a nice ball, does a nice job of reading defenses, and he's got an amazing knack to extend plays, get out of tough spots, and extend the play and then make something happen or just prevent the sack.
Lupoli played a little against James Madison because Knight was out with an injury, played the whole second half, played well. He was 8-for-10 in the win at Central Arkansas. Regardless of who plays quarterback, though, their offensive line has had some issues. They've given up over 50 sacks this year.
Well, and part of that maybe is just, a little bit of shuffling around on the offensive line with some injuries, illnesses and things like that. And then just so many different things that that New Hampshire offense throws at you. The different looks and just the different plays that they run that sometimes, you just get caught in a bad situation where defenses just maybe have the perfect call designed. And so you can't put a ton of stock into all of that. I expect New Hampshire will come out regardless whoever's at the quarterback position, and they're going to try and do what they do best and take it to the Jacks and see if they can't get out to an early lead.
In the Missouri Valley Football Conference, we see a lot of talented receiving corps, and most of them are anchored by 6'3", 6'4", long-armed receivers. This is an excellent receiving corps from New Hampshire, but they're guys who are smaller stature-wise. Neil O'Connor has 93 catches. He's 5'11". You have Malik Love in the slot, who is excellent, but O'Connor really is the bell cow for them, 1,538 yards and 10 touchdowns.
Well, they're very athletic, skilled guys out there at that wide receiver position, and really kind of shifty, crafty veteran guys. They're able to make plays. They have good speed, good quickness, good change of direction. And so that's part of the reason why is they maybe have so many catches. They maybe do a little bit more in the short passing game. But because of the athletic ability of each of those guys, they're able to turn those short routes into big gains for that New Hampshire offense.
Defensively, they run a 4-2-5, but in reality, similar to what SDSU does at times, they'll have that third linebacker almost be a third safety. In reality, this is a New Hampshire defense between the 20s that is almost a mirror image of South Dakota State's.
They really are kind of that bend, don't break type mentality where they're going to make the offense drive the length of the field and earn all the yards, not give up any big plays over the top. But then once you get down inside that red zone, then they're going to dial up the pressure. They're going to come after you and play a lot of man coverage.
The two numbers that stand out about them, they forced 27 turnovers, including 8 in the first two playoff games. And in the red zone, teams only score 60% of the time. Mike, you're here on Math Tells You. 2 out of every 5 trips an opposing offense makes in the red zone, they don't score against New Hampshire.
And part of that is just the pressure that they bring when you get down there close to the goal line, and you're not sure where it's coming from. So they have a tendency to create some turnovers down inside the red zone. And so whether it's a tipped ball at the line of scrimmage or whether it's a sack and a forced fumble or something like that, or making you make quick decisions and maybe not getting a true read on the defense and having to get rid of the ball before the receiver's making his break and such. So, you know, that'll be an interesting dilemma on Saturday to see how the Jacks are able to handle that pressure, if they're able to pick it up, if they need to keep an extra guy in to help, you know, with some of that pass protection, and then just to see who can win those one-on-one battles.
Final point, when we look at special teams, punt return game, kick return game, bottom 10 nationally for New Hampshire. Their kicking unit has struggled right around 50% for the year in field goals. They do punt the ball well, but the Jacks usually feel special teams is an advantage. They feel that way this week.
Yeah, and the Jacks certainly do have the advantage this week, and Chase Vinatieri has really been hitting the ball well, striking it good, as evident last week with that 55-yard field goal. But, you know, the kick return unit for SDSU has been very solid all year long. Kickoff coverage has been good as well. You know, punt return, we don't typically get a big returns, but ball security is huge on that aspect of the game. And so Jacks, on paper, have the advantage with special teams.
And your support will be huge as well. Tomorrow afternoon, 2 o'clock the kick, as South Dakota State hosts New Hampshire in the FCS quarterfinals inside Dana J. Dykhouse Stadium. Check out 866-GO-JACK, 688-5422, or jackrabbittickets.com to join us tomorrow at 2 o'clock for the FCS quarterfinals.